Hello everyone and welcome to this Moodle Academy webinar, Introduction to Moodle for Educators. I'm Mary Cooch and I'm Education Manager here at Moodle, and I'm going to be presenting to you today, and with me monitoring the chat and at intervals during the webinar answering your questions and comments is Education Advisor Anna Krasser. Anna.
Hello everyone, welcome in our session today. I hope it will be a live and vivid session. Feel free to keep an eye on the chat and of course all your questions and everything, your comments in the chat. We are actively monitoring it.
Okay, thank you. Now, this webinar is for complete beginners to Moodle. And I just want to make it clear that when you're a beginner in Moodle, there are actually two parts to learning Moodle. There's what we call Moodle administration, which is setting up your site to make it attractive or to brand it, and adding the teaching spaces, which Moodle calls courses, and then getting teachers and students into those courses. That's administration. And then there is what we call teaching with Moodle, which is how a teacher can actually add resources, files, activities, assignments for their students to do in their subject in the course. So this webinar is about teaching with Moodle. If you are actually interested in the administration side of Moodle, then last week we did a webinar, and in the course where you came to get into this webinar, you can access that recording, Introduction to Moodle for Administrators, and also the slides. Don't leave us now though, watch this webinar, and then afterwards feel free to access the administrator recording as well. So looking at an Introduction to Moodle for Educators, I think it's important to clarify certain key terms that are part of Moodle before we get started. Now, as I just said, the teaching materials and activities that you want to use Moodle for live in what Moodle calls a course. And it is basically just a page or a space on your Moodle site. It might be that it lasts several weeks or months and it's divided into weekly sections with a start and an end time, but it doesn't have to be. It could just be a place which is permanently available where you just have your files that you used in your face-to-face classes. It's very much what you want it to be. And courses are usually created by the Moodle admin or a manager who tends not to have a teaching role. Now, of course, you might be a new MoodleCloud owner, and you might be both an administrator and a teacher if you have a small site or a few users. That's fine. But typically in organizations, teachers don't create the course, but they do add the materials and teach in it. And that's our focus for today. The official name for that role in Moodle is editing teacher. That means that you can add the teaching materials and delete them. You can add activities and you can teach and grade within the course. The people who come into your course to learn have the official name of student. However, I'll show you that you can, if you don't like those, you can actually change them within your course. Maybe you want to call your student learner or trainee or employee or pupil. Maybe you don't want to be visible as teacher, but trainer, and so on. You might also be interested in a role called non-editing teacher. This is a little bit like a classroom assistant. So they will help you in the course. They can't add or delete your teaching materials, but they can grade and moderate the forums and so on. So those are some useful words, and now we're going to look at how we're going to divide up this webinar. So in the first part, we're going to look at setting up your course. Then we'll have a quick break for questions. Then we're going to look at how you can add your teaching materials. And then once we've added our course content, then and only then, how we can give our learners access. And then at the end, I'll share with you some links and resources and courses to find out more, because obviously we can't tell you everything in this 1 hour. So let's imagine then that we're a teacher on a Moodle site. We're going to follow Alex, in fact, and Alex has had a course already created for them by the Moodle admin. Here it is in the My Courses page, which in Moodle 4, that's the latest version of Moodle. That's what MoodleCloud people have and other sites if they've upgraded to the latest version. There's a page, My Courses, which shows all the courses where you're either a teacher or a student. So teacher Alex has been given a course, Basic French. There's no explanation about it, no description, and it has got quite a dull blue pattern that doesn't say much. So one of the first things we will do is how we can add some information about Alex's course and perhaps add a photo to make it a bit more attractive. So let's follow Alex going into this course as a new teacher in a completely new course. And you see there that this is quite empty. You also notice that what's in the central area is divided into sections or cards, topic 1, 2, and that's replicated or repeated on the left-hand side. I'll explain about that in a moment. But first of all, let's take a look at the links that are underneath the title, Basic French. This is the course navigation. Some of it kind of makes sense. Only the teacher sees all of these. Participants is where you would go to see who is a student in your course or to add more reports. That kind of makes sense. If you click the more link, there are more links for you, the teacher. For example, question bank is where you would go if you wanted to start creating questions for quizzes in your course that you could then bring into various quizzes. Content bank is where you would go to create an activity called H5P. Many people are familiar with it. It's not Moodle, but it is integrated or works with Moodle to make some attractive activities that can be graded. And other links as well, badges. Course reuse is where you can go and save your course to give it to someone else, or maybe where you can bring in a course that someone's given to you. But we're going to start right at the beginning, and we're going to go to the link settings, which only the teacher sees. And this is, I always like to describe it as going backstage or around the back of the course page into the course settings, where we can, for example, if we are allowed as a teacher, change the course full name and short name. They can both be the same if you don't have a very long name. And then we'll notice that there are quite a few settings. It's worth exploring all of them. Check the question mark icons. They always give you a bit of help. What we'd like to do, though, I think, following Alex, is to give a summary of what this course is about so that when people come to the course, they actually have more information. So we've added that. Then we can scroll further down and we can add a course image. I tend to make mine about 600 by 400 approximate pixels that will then display instead of that rather bland blue pattern. So we can add a course image. You might need to experiment if you want a certain aspect of that image to display. And then some other settings that might be interesting to you, we sadly don't have time to look at them all, course format. So you'll see that it says here topics format. This is the most versatile because this is simply those numbered sections which you can change to suit your purposes. Alex, as a French teacher, would rename them from topic 1, 2, 3, etc. to listening, reading, speaking, writing, the skills. If you have a course that runs on a time schedule, if we click the drop down, you can choose weekly format. Weekly format will start the weeks and display each section as weeks according to when you begin your course. And there are other formats as well. and make sure you check the question mark icons for information. Personally, I think most of the time, I'm quite happy using topics format. Now, we can't go through all of these because we don't have time, but a couple that might be interesting to you. Completion tracking, sometimes called activity completion, is something that's turned on by default in your course, and it allows your students and you to see what needs to be completed, what your student has to do, and what they still have to do. And you also can have a report of what they've done and what they need to do. If you don't think you'll need this because you don't need them to have anything checked off, then you can turn it off. But wait and see how it looks and how it's used before you make that decision. Many people think it's helpful. And if you recall, I said, if you don't like to see the word student or you don't like to see the word teacher, you can rename those roles in role renaming. Let's just go back to the My Courses page, where you can actually see now that the image is much more attractive. Alex has a new image of the Eiffel Tower in a Francophone country. And you'll see on the right, you can select the kind of view for the My Courses page. We're looking at card view now, but if I click the drop down, there's also list view and summary view. Summary view is what I'm showing you now, and that's where the course description went, just out of interest there. So now we need to get into the course and get started. So let's take a look at these sections now. There's a number one, top left, next to something called the course index. So the course index repeats what is in the main central area, and that's where you have your documents, files, your activities, and so on. And so everything that's in the main central area is also in the course index, and you can see that it's a lot more compact, so it's easy for you to search for things or move things if you wish, if you have a long page, in the course index. And you can, if you want to, if you don't want to see it, you can collapse it by clicking the X, and then you'll have the whole page view. On the right at the top, my number two is pointing to a toggle that says edit mode. Now, we can't at the moment change anything on this page, and I'd like to change this general to something more welcoming, like welcome. I think as a language teacher, Alex wants to change those numbered topics to listening, reading, to the skills, but we can't do anything until we toggle edit mode. So let's do that now and see how it changes. So now you can see edit mode is on, that's where my number two is. And you can see on the left, the course index has been collapsed, so we can view the whole page there. And we can click to open it again if needed. Also on the right-hand side, next to where I put a number three, there seems to be a tantalizing little arrow wanting us to open it up. And this is what is called a block drawer. Let's open it up, where you can add blocks. Blocks are areas that you can add extra information to your Moodle course. It's not where you do your teaching, but you can have some extra useful things in the blocks drawer as a teacher, which your students can then see. Now, we're not going to add blocks or focus on them, but if we just click it to see the kinds of things available, you can see, for example, activity results. That's a league table. So you could have an activity results block as a league table for quiz results if you want to get some gamification or competition in your course. There is a course completion status block. This is a block that your students could see to find out in one view what they've completed and what they still have to complete, and they can click to see exactly what they need to do, and other blocks as well. But let's just leave that for now. And because we have edit mode enabled, we can now change those names to something more suiting to this course. And the easiest and quickest way of changing the titles is with edit mode enabled, just clicking that pencil icon, typing in the title or name that you want for that section, and then pressing enter or return or whatever, just like this. Okay, so now it says welcome. You'll also see next to the right of topic one that another way you can do this is by clicking the three dots, and you can see it says edit topic. If you click there, you can not only change that topic one, but you can also give a little summary of what is going to be in that section, because our teaching materials will go in these individual sections. From those three dots, you can also highlight it. You can hide a topic until you're ready to show it. It's one way that you can move it. You can move things by drag and drop in several ways in Moodle, or you can delete it if you don't want it. So if we click edit topic, we can change this topic one to listening and then add a little summary. And as a hint, make sure to go to the bottom of the page and click the button so you've saved your changes. And there we have listening. And Alex, we'll leave Alex to go and rename the other topics as well, reading, speaking, writing. If you discover that you've got your topic set up and then you realize you need to add another one, see, you can simply click to add a new topic or new section in between the other sections. That's fine. If, however, your course runs weekly, do you remember the weekly course format? You have to do that from the bottom of the page to add a new week, because it's simply not possible in the laws of the universe to actually insert a week in the second week of September before the third week of September. So you have to go to the bottom to do that. That's one reason why topics format is quite handy. Now, we've got our course set up, we've got edit mode turned on, we've renamed some of the sections. So I'm going to pause for a little while to see if you have some questions or comments before we then start adding the teaching materials. So over to you, Anna.
We had a few notes and questions. Actually, I have already answered them. Egert said that in the old version of Moodle, there was this possibility to move the URL and files to the side. I cannot do that anymore. And I think he's referring either to the social course format, either to theme.
I think you might possibly be referring to what we call indent, which is an arrow, and you press the arrow and then you can have some resources going a little bit into the right.
Oh,
if that's what you mean.
Yes, that could be also the case. Yes.
It has been removed for various research reasons. It was suggested to remove it. However, the Moodle team, the developers, are currently exploring the possibility or ways of bringing it back. Not for the immediate future, but this is under discussion because quite a few people have asked about this. Yeah. If you're new to Moodle and you don't know what we're talking about, it's fine. It's fine.
Harold says, is it possible to share the recording of the session with course assistants who have non-editing teachers in my course? Of course. The recording will be available through the course, and it will be available through YouTube in a couple of days after some fine-tuning. Yeah. And Julia says, how do you change the main course name, Basic French?
All right. So if you remember, when we clicked settings in the course navigation, that's where you saw Basic French and French 101. And if you wanted to change the course name, that's where you would go to change it from settings. In some organizations, they don't let teachers change the course name. But if you're in charge of your course and you can, that's where you would change it. So not on the main page, but backstage, round the back in the settings. Okay.
Dawn is asking, can you change role names as a default setting for all course trainers and delegates?
You can from the site administration. So that's a site admin thing. However, if you've got Moodle Cloud, I don't think you can do that, but the site admin can change the language for all of them if that's what you want and if they have that possibility. That's more of an admin question, really.
Saron asks, is there an option to add an image to a category?
An image to a category? I think yes. However, it's not. We're not actually dealing with categories. We're dealing with individual courses. Could I just point out one of the resources I'm going to give you at the end is Moodle.org forums. And questions like that are great for the Moodle.org forums, where I live there, basically. So I'll be more than happy to answer that kind of extra questions over there.
Katja says that in topic format, what would be a good way to announce events with date and time, content and speaker, etc.? Is it through format or is there another activity that would suit better?
To announce?
Oh, so say not format, but forum, okay.
Well, forum is great. The announcements forum is probably the best. However, I have a new feature of Moodle 4 that I want to show you that will enable you to very easily announce new activities and resources and so on, certainly.
Also, Julia says, is there a way to make the course category yourself? I'm not saying that it doesn't pull up a lot of options. Getting miscellaneous.
Yeah. So if you have a brand new Moodle site, then you will get a free category ready made. Depending on whether you are Moodle Cloud or a different Moodle site, it will either say miscellaneous or it will say category one. If you want to make more categories, then you need to be the admin and you need to check our administrator webinar, I think. As a course teacher, you can't create a category. Possibly if other categories are there, you can change a category, but that's an admin thing again.
It seems that we have quite a lot of questions. And William's asking, how can you change the layout of the course so that it's like boxes that students can click on it instead of the default list view?
As well as the weekly and topics course format that we showed, there are other formats, that's what Moodle calls them, displays of the course that your administrator can add for you. And you might be thinking there is one that's called grid, that's a series of boxes, but that doesn't come with standard Moodle. So if your administrator is able to add additional course formats, what we call plugins, then they can do that for you. It's not a standard format.
Okay. And Robert says that I noticed that the report option moves depending on the course type. Sometimes you see it on the menu bar, and for other types of source, it is under the course option in the menu bar.
Yes, quite possibly. I don't know. As a course teacher, I would access it from reports there. In the course administration, course navigation, sorry. Should we do more or should we?
Yes, should we move on? Yes, we are good.
Okay. And remember, we have a forum in this course and in Introduction to Moodle. We also have the Moodle.org forums. Please go to the Teaching with Moodle forum on Moodle.org to ask other teaching related questions. I think we're going to start now looking at adding our teaching materials. In terms of adding our teaching materials, if you remember, we'd already got our course with edit mode turned on. And so the simplest way and the first way that many people want to add materials is simply by finding them on their computer. I got one on my desktop, a PDF, clicking on them and simply dragging them into the course page. So here is a PDF that's living just out of view on my desktop, and I'm clicking it and dragging it into the welcome section. You can drag it to anywhere. If you make a mistake, you can move it. Once you let go of it, you can see it says drop files here to add them to the bottom of this section. And when I let go of the PDF, there it is, file class rules. And if you didn't want it there after all, If you click on it, you'll see this crosshairs icon. You can move things up or down into a different place. So dragging and dropping is a really quick and easy way of bringing in PowerPoint presentations, Word documents, files, and so on. And actually, in terms of dragging and dropping, you can drag and drop not only in the central area, but you can also drag and drop from the course index here, because remember, it repeats or replicates what's in the central area. And if you have a long main course page, you can drag something from a course section up into where you want it in the course index, which is a bit compact and it might be easier to manage. And it's not only documents and resources that you can drag and drop, you can also drag and drop sections. So Alex here has renamed the sections to reading and speaking, and then decides that they want to move reading up above listening. I don't necessarily agree, but it's not my course. And so Alex simply needs to click reading. You see the crosshairs icon, and drag it and let go up above listening. And there it is. So as you can see, there are various ways of dragging and dropping activities and sections, not to mention the one we saw from the three dots earlier on. Now, it's all very well dragging and dropping files, but that's only one tiny aspect of teaching in a Moodle course. And perhaps you can't or don't want to drag and drop files. If we click add an activity or resource in any section, and remember, if we click the wrong section, we can always drag and drop things to move them, we get what Moodle calls the activity chooser. And here we see all of the options that you can use to teach with Moodle. Most of these come with all Moodle sites as standard. Depending on who is hosting your Moodle, you might have some extra ones. For example, attendance is an extra feature that MoodleCloud users benefit from, where they can have students recording their attendance. But most of these, everyone has. Now, you can see that this is all of them, but they then divide them into activities and resources. And if we click resources, a resource in Moodle is something static that a student listens to, reads, or watches. They don't actually engage with it or interact with it. So you can see we have URL. That's a link to a website. So that's an easy one for you to make a web link so they don't have to get lost in Google. You can upload your files from here instead of drag and drop, and you can organize them neatly into a folder with the folder resource. If there is a resource or activity that you don't understand, maybe you don't know what label is, you can click the I and it takes you to Moodle's documentation, which will explain it and even have a little video to help you use it. And if there's one that you think you're going to be using a lot, you can click the star, that's to favorite or bookmark it, and Moodle will create another tab here for your starred, favorited, bookmarked resources and activities. If you're planning on adding a lot of files, Word documents, simply with information, I would suggest you look at Moodle's page instead. And as an example resource, let's just click page and see how it works. So Alex is going to make a page called About Your Teacher, where they're going to add some information about Alex the teacher. You can, if you want to, add a description, which if you tick that box, will display on the course page so students know what it's about. They would click the link, which is formed by name, to get into the page. And again, note I've mentioned these little question mark icons. In Moodle 4, bottom right of all of the pages where you're a teacher, you'll see another question mark icon, which takes you to help and documentation. That will go straight to Moodle documentation for that page. And so you have context, in context, specific help for wherever you are in Moodle. And if you're using an older version of Moodle or another version of Moodle, you might see it in the footer saying Moodle Docs for this page. But do be aware of that. obviously the content now that Alex is going to add goes where it says page content. So typing some information about Alex's qualifications and enthusiasm for the course. And you'll see that in this toolbar, this text editor, it's called Atto. That's Moodle's default text editor's name. But you can, if your administrator allows, you can use something called TinyMCE, which is a very popular text editor used in many other sites around the internet. And see, the benefit of doing this on Moodle is that you can add links which people can click on, you can add images, and you can even, there's a microphone and a webcam there, video camera, you can even record your voice or record your video introducing yourself as a teacher in the course, which you can't do if you simply upload a Word document or a PDF. So do consider using a page. It's better for your students as well, and particularly if they're on their smartphones. Something else that I would like to point out towards the bottom here is, is whenever you add something new in Moodle, Moodle 4, or if you update something, then there is a box you can tick to notify your students, and they will get alerted either as an email or maybe on their smartphones or on the website that something is new or something has changed. And this is, to me, a great feature of Moodle that allows you to very easily let them know when you've added something new. Okay, now, if you think you're going to have a lot of pages that are connected, I would suggest you look at a book. A book is exactly that. It's a series of connected pages. Some people like to teach in Moodle using a book where you have different information on each page. And of course, you can also embed videos or links and images in those books. I won't show you how to make one because the process is quite similar. But in the course where this webinar is, Introduction to Moodle, there is a book called About This Course. And you should already have clicked on it. If you haven't, go and you will see it has a table of content, and each section or page has different but connected information. So that's a book which is several connected pages together. However, although resources are very useful and in some cases essential, many people think that to get your students really motivated and engaged, you need to get them typing into Moodle, interacting with each other, collaborating with each other, and so on. And so we would look at activities. Activities are aspects, content in Moodle, where students have to do something. Quite often, they're also graded. So we have forums, for example, that's where you can start discussions. We have choice, that's Moodle's quick poll. Think how useful a quick poll would be. There is a quiz activity, and Moodle has many different types of quiz questions, although you need to think carefully when you create them. We are running a webinar and we are starting a course creating quality quiz questions in November. So if you're new to quiz and you think you might use it a lot, sign up for that webinar, creating quality quiz questions. It's on the front page of Academy. And I'm going to actually, as our example, I'm going to use assignments, partly because it's the first one alphabetically in the English version of Moodle, but partly because it's a good way of me showing you the settings in common for all of these activities. So if we click assignments, again, you'll see that whatever we type in name is going to form the link that the students will click on to get to that assignment. An assignment is where they have to submit something to you, the teacher, and you grade it manually. If you want automatic grading, think about quiz, for instance. You can give it a description if you want and tick that box if you want, but what is important, and this is new in Moodle 4, is that you need to type the activity instructions. So when the student clicks to begin the assignment, they know what they are doing. I'm going to read these out to you because it's important as part of the assignment settings. You may type directly into Moodle or upload a word process document. In other words, you can do whatever you want, that they can submit whatever you request, any type of file, if you can read it yourself, one or more files, links to somewhere online, or if it's an essay and just information, they can type it into Moodle as an online assignment. You may not write more than 500 words. If it's an online text they're typing, you can actually set a word limit. And my third sentence, you will be required to accept the agreement that it's your own work. In other words, this is an option that you can set. So before they can submit their work, whatever it is, they have to promise that it's their own. And those are just three of the many assignment settings that you can see when you set one up. And you can see here that all of these are different settings, and you can click to expand them to find out more. Submission types is where you decide, do you want them to type online or do you want them to upload a file? In feedback types, you can decide how you want to give them feedback. Do you want to type directly over their work as if it was paper? Do you want to record your feedback audio or video? Or would you prefer to type it offline in Word and upload it? You have all these possibilities, okay? What I want to do, again, for lack of time, is I want to show you two settings which are common to all activities and resources that may interest you. And the first one is called restrict access. Now, restrict access means that you can hide either this assignment or any of your other content until such a time that you decide. So for example, our teacher Alex could hide this end of unit essay until the end, the last day of the course or the week before the end of the course, a specific date. Or, and this is a very popular way of using restrict access, you could hide it until they've completed one or more of the other activities in the course. When I say hide, you can either hide it completely so they don't even know it exists, or you can hide it with a little teaser saying, this activity is available when you have done this, 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 and this, okay? And that's activity completion. But if you want to do that, you need to define what those completion conditions are. So if we look at activity completion, remember, this is also called completion tracking in the course settings. You can, for each of your activities, either turn it off if you don't want them to, if you don't need it, or you can set it to be manually marked. So they would have to click a button to say, done this. Sometimes that's useful, sometimes not, because they don't actually have to do it to press the button. But if you select students can manually mark the activity as completed, as soon as you select that, Moodle then presents you with conditions or criteria dependent on the activity that you are doing. So for instance, a graded activity like an assignment or a quiz, student must receive a grade to complete this activity, or student must submit to this activity. You decide what the criteria are. And each activity and resource has its own personal, customized settings. So for example, I'm going to hide all of the other settings and just expand the activity completion conditions in another Moodle activity. You can see here. So what might this be? Well, you can grade it, but that's not the most important feature here, because if you look, some of the criteria are focusing on students must post discussions, students must reply to discussions. So these are the criteria for activity completion of a forum, for example, okay? So those are two settings common to all the activities that you might like to explore. I'm going to stop there simply because we're short on time, and I think it's a good time to start looking at the questions in the chat, Anna.
Yep, and again, we had several of them. Aziman asked, is it possible students' work in assignment to be assessed with a rubric by more than one teacher?
Yes, this is a bit more advanced than basic Moodle, but yes, you can set up something called marking allocation and workflow where teachers can look at each other's work and so on. So the short answer is yes. The long answer is it's a bit more advanced than this webinar.
Yep, I have actually redirected him to the assessment exploring assignments where this is something that he can find there. And Julia, so how did you get to the add an activity or resource view?
Well, we turned on edit, we enabled edit mode top right, or turn on editing depending on your version of Moodle. And then you will have the link in each of the sections, add an activity or resource. If you have an older version of Moodle, it might be a little link. In the latest version, it's that big link in the central area.
Okay, someone from West College Scotland asks, is the folder resource accessible for screen readers?
I don't know is the answer, but you've made me want to go and try as soon as we finish this webinar. Do you know, Anna?
I haven't tried either. I think that the environment is accessible, but of course the content needs to be downloaded and open it as a file. We have a question from Malik. The question is in French. I have managed to translate. This is about the translation. If it's he actually asks if is it possible to translate in French this webinar so he can understand things better. And of course, I found the chance to mention that we are translating the courses in Moodle Academy, but we are inviting volunteers from the community, and you are very welcome to participate in this process. So hopefully at some time we will have everything translated in several languages, but we cannot really tell when.
Yeah, this course introduction to Moodle I think is already translated into French, but the webinar would need someone to translate the transcript and or even to give us a transcript for YouTube when it appears on YouTube. Okay. Je ne suis pas français, mais je continue en anglais. Any other questions?
Teresa is asking, can you add a narrated PowerPoint slideshow in Moodle? If so, what is the best way to put it in the course?
Personally, I wouldn't, simply because, I mean, you can add a narrated PowerPoint slide, you can add anything in Moodle, but your student, you would just upload it as a file, but your students would then have to download it in order to get it working. You can't easily embed them. There are ways, but to be honest, you can't easily embed a PowerPoint. You can do something in Google Docs and slide share. I think that's one way that you could put it in SlideShare, but that's an external site, and embed the SlideShare. I've seen that done sometimes. Don't know if you have any other ideas, Anna.
Well, what I did in the past was to export the narrated PowerPoint into a video and upload the video into the course. But depending the how big your file is, I'm not sure that that would be the best idea either for every case. Katja is asking, is it possible to send students notifications in form of text message or similar, like a reminder or something?
Yes, well, you can message them from the messaging within your course. If you go into the course, let me think. If you go in and set up groups in your course, then from participants, groups, you can then create a group messaging where you can then go to the messaging in your course and you can message all of the students together in your course if you've put them into a group. Groups is something that we look at in some of our academy courses, which I'll be pointing out later on. And that kind of thing is something that's covered in our Moodle teaching skills program. Okay.
Well, I'm happy to see that Julia found the turn editing on button and found the how to add an activity. And Egert says that, is there a text reader built in the Moodle?
Is there a what? Sorry,
text
Bill?
Reader. Text reader.
A text reader. No, I don't think there's a text reader built into Moodle. There is a plugin, I think, called Read Aloud, but I don't think there's anything standard in Moodle. But you can use things from your browser, for example, or there are other open source options that you can use to read what is in your Moodle course, I think.
And he also asks, is it possible to buy more space for files to host in Moodle? I think
in MoodleCloud, I don't think it's possible to buy more file hosting space in MoodleCloud. That's why you are suggested to try and you and your students to try and use external sites such as Google Drive or Microsoft OneDrive, Dropbox, and so on. Depending on what your hosts are, if it's not MoodleCloud, certainly you should be able to negotiate with them.
Yep, and I think we are ready to move on.
Okay, then. So, assuming we've added lots of exciting, engaging teaching materials, we're now going to look at how to give your learners access to the course. And it's important to understand here as beginner Moodle teachers that getting into your course is a two-step process. First, you need to get on the site, and then you need to get into the course. So if you imagine this blue and orange house is your Moodle site, learners must first have accounts on the site before they can access your course. And as a teacher, you can't get them into the site. You can only get them into the course. It's the admin who creates the accounts or allows learners to create their own accounts. And then you, the teacher, can decide how to allow them into your course. So we're looking at two things here. And the first is called authentication. It's useful to know these key terms for if you have any problems and you need to contact a support help desk. Authentication means getting people onto your site, giving them accounts, letting them create their own accounts. That's what the admin does. We as the teacher, and Alex is our example teacher here, needs enrollment. Enrollment means getting people into your courses, either by adding them yourself or letting them sign up themselves to your courses. Enrollment with one L if you are British or Australian, enrollment with two L's if you are American, both are correct, neither is a spelling mistake. And if we're going to look at enrollment, we need to go into the course. Here is Alex's course, and we need to click participants. When we click participants, we'll see a big blue button here, enroll users, and that is where we can click to manually, individually enroll people into our course. So if we click that button there, in the first box, you would search for and select people from throughout the Moodle site, as long as they already have accounts to add to your course, and then you would give them a role. Now, most times as a teacher, you will assign them the role as student. It's possible as a teacher, you want to give your colleague the non-editing teacher role, if you remember the classroom assistant. A regular course teacher cannot add other editing teachers to their course. You'll need to ask your admin for that. But most of the times you would add them as a student. Now, this is fine if you only have a few students, but many of you might prefer it if your students could actually just see your course, read the description, look at that attractive Eiffel Tower, and sign up or enroll themselves. So let's cancel that. And instead, if we click the drop down, enrolled users here, and notice whoever was asking about groups and group messaging, this is where you'd set up a group, then you could enable group messaging. We need to click enrollment methods. That's the different ways that people can get into the course. And you'll see grayed out self-enrollment. If we simply go to the right where it says edit column and click the eye icon to open the eye, make it visible, that will then enable or turn on the feature for students to enroll themselves into the course. And that's all you need to do. You might like, however, to explore a few options by clicking the cog icon. So if we click that, optionally, you can add an enrollment key, that's a password to the course So only the people you've already told the enrollment key or password, only they can get into the course. If you're running a course over a period of time and you only want, say, 25 people or 50 people, you can limit the numbers who can enroll. And a nice touch, you can personalize the welcome message they get when they receive the email to say they're enrolled in your course. So those are three things which you can optionally do, but as long as you open the eye icon to make it visible, a student can then see your course on the front page, the home page, available courses. You see there's a little arrow there. Click it and you'll see it says self-enrollment student, and they just need to click that button and they are in your course. Now that's two ways that you, the teacher, can get students into your course. There are other ways, more useful, particularly if you're going to have a lot of students, and they are in the control of the admin. So I can't show you those, but I will point them out so that you're aware of them. For example, your administrator can upload a CSV file, a spreadsheet, with all your students and your course, put them straight into the course for you. Your admin can also do something called cohorts, which are groups of students, which he or she can put into your course for you as a unit. These are the kinds of things that admins do. So feel free to look at our Introduction to Moodle for Administrators webinar if that interests you, or if you are an admin as well as a teacher. Okay, that was very short, because in terms of adding teachers and students, there's not much that teachers can do, but I hope I've explained a few of the things. So I'm going to quickly go on to, if there are any other questions and comments, then we'll finish with the links to get help more and just a little bit of other information.
Great. We do have a couple of questions. Alina is asking, how can we enroll a list of students like input from Excel?
Right.
And Alex has set the link from Moodle documentation cohorts.
Okay, so those questions have already been answered in my last slide. Your admin will upload a list of students in Excel saved as a CSV file, or the admin can add cohorts. Okay.
And Julia says that, is there a max on how many people can self-enroll in a course based on your plan with Moodle?
Well, if you are only allowed 200 users, I'm making up a figure, you can only enroll 200 users into the course, really. If you've got a huge site that's got thousands of users, you could enroll thousands of users into your course. It's the limit of the number of people allowed on your Moodle site.
Okay. Also, Edgar comes back in a question that he made at the beginning about the option to move the topics to the site, but I'm not sure exactly what he means. He asked at the beginning, how can we move links and files to the site, and you perceive that as the ident option that used to be there.
Mm-hmm. Was that not the same question?
Yes, he's saying that I can, I had a reply that perhaps I have perceived differently. So oh. I thought that in a social course format, all the links and yes. of the activities and resources yes. are set aside into the blog.
That's a good format to use, yeah? If you just, social format is basically a big message board of lots of different forum discussions, and then any other activities you want in your course will appear to one side in an activities block, yeah?
But he says that I cannot find the social course format to move the topics to the side. So I'm not sure what he's,
okay, right.
exactly what's the problem.
Okay, perhaps you'd like to either post in the Introduction to Moodle forum or in the Teaching with Moodle forum, and I can explain to you step by step what to do there, okay?
Yep, okay. I think we can move on.
Okay, then, right.
Okay. Oh, sorry. Two last actually. Hilary said that before the last Moodle update, I had the student block for comments and notes in a block at the site. Is this still possible?
I'm not sure which block you mean, student block for comments and
The blog.
The blog. Okay. Yes, if it should be, you should be able to add the blog block. With Moodle 4, some blocks that are not considered useful have been hidden from various areas in Moodle. So it might be worth checking with your admin there.
And West College of Scotland asks, your admin might not allow you to use the social topics format. That's an answer to Edward.
Okay then. So I'm just going to give you a few tips as to where you can find out more and then how you can help us to build and grow Moodle Academy. So you'll notice I said several times about the question marks, not only next to each setting, but also at the bottom of the page as a course teacher. Do check them if you get a bit lost. Help and documentation, which takes you to the Moodle documentation. docs.moodle.org is the direct link if you want to go there directly. And we also have documentation in other languages, some better than others. It's very comprehensive in German and Spanish. It's quite good in French as well, other languages less so. But I do want to point out finally that if you're new to teaching with Moodle or if you know a little bit, please explore our educator pathway. We have a program of courses designed both for beginner teachers, that's teaching basics, and for teachers who've done a little bit. On this site on Moodle Academy, Moodle Teaching Basics Program and Certificate, everything you need to begin with Moodle. And then if you've been using it for a while, as I feel some of you have here, Moodle Teaching Skills Program and Certificate. Entirely free, you get a free badge. You can purchase a certificate by all means, but please explore those as an educator in Moodle. And continuing with the Moodle Academy theme, please go to our Get Involved. You'll see a light bulb, click Get Involved, and suggest topics that we can cover in future webinars and courses. And you can also, if you are an experienced Moodler or you know someone who is, present a webinar, co-present with us or present a webinar on Moodle Academy, or even co-create or create courses such as the ones that you're seeing on Moodle Academy. And for both of those, you can get an Academy badge. And then finally, we want more people coming to our webinars and doing our courses so we can spread the word. So please tell your friends and colleagues about Moodle Academy. So earn a badge. And also, when you become an experienced Moodler or any experienced Moodle educators, please explore our Moodle Educator Certification. This is a very high quality program of courses for experienced Moodlers, which is run through our certified service providers, purchased, but it's a very high quality certificate for experienced Moodlers. So all of those options are available to you.
Okay, I'll just quickly go through a couple notes in the chat. Matt is asking about the future plans for further development in Moodle future versions. And I have redirect him into the roadmap and Moodle documentation.
Great.
West College of Scotland says that, thank you very much. I think this recording will be very useful to our tutors. And we have been highlighting, promoting the Moodle Academy to them. And this might be a good in. Yeah. Thank you. And lots of thanks from pretty much everyone, I would say.
That's nice.
So thank you all very much for being here. It was really a pleasure.
Thank you. Thank you very much.